everyone. Well, it's a little bit of an unusual Easter in that we can't meet in person, but being socially distanced isn't going to stop us from celebrating our risen Savior. So we'd like to share one of our favorite Easter songs with you and hope that you'll sing along with us if you know the song.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. We want to give you a very big welcome. Happy Resurrection Sunday. And we want to thank the Kearney family for opening up our time of worship today. Today, we're going to have a mix of live and recorded singing. And we want to invite you to join right in and sing along with all of the songs. You're welcome to do that. Matthew 28:6 says, "He is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay." And that's the truth that we celebrate today, our risen Savior. And I want to encourage you to go ahead and find your Bible, because later on in our service, we're going to be looking at that passage, and you're going to need to follow along with your Bible, so I encourage you to have that handy. Today we celebrate and we rejoice, and we're going to be sharing. I know one of the things that we all miss is getting to see one another, so we've prepared a greeting video with many of the families of Lake Hills. We're going to begin our service that way at this time.
Happy Easter from the Archers.
We miss our peeps.
Happy Easter, Lake Hills.
Happy Easter from the Fleming family.
Happy Easter.
Hello, Lake Hills. Have a happy Easter.
Happy Resurrection Sunday from the Nanko family.
Happy Easter from the Michelsons.
Happy Easter, Lake Hills family. Love you all.
Hello, Lake Hills family. Praise the Lord, for Jesus is risen. Have a happy Easter from your favorite intern, Ian.
His eye is on the sparrow. Happy Easter from the Deckers. Happy Easter. morning, Lake Hills family. So I'm glad that we're able to worship with you this morning.
Happy Easter from the Ogden family.
Hey, Lake Hills Baptist Church. Jesus is alive. Hallelujah. Happy Easter from the Campingas.
Hello from the Newman family. We're sad we can't be together on Easter, but we love and miss you all and can't wait to be back together again. We just want to wish everyone happy Easter.
Happy Easter from the Chapmans.
Happy Easter, Lake Hills. We love you.
Happy Easter, everybody.
Hello, everyone.
Happy Easter from the Macklemores.
Happy Easter from the Schmucker family.
Blessed Easter from Pat and Norm Pulaski. Missing you all. Christ is risen and coming again. Hallelujah.
Happy Easter from Bud Ellinghausen.
Happy Easter from the Windlebirds.
Hello, everyone. We're doing well. We missed the fellowship at Lake Hills Baptist Church. Happy Easter from the Brister family.
We may be sheltering in place, but we still celebrate the one who is Lord of every place.
Happy Easter from the Lindbeck family.
He is risen indeed.
Celebrate! Jesus is alive! Happy Easter, church family. We love you.
Happy Easter!
Happy Easter from the Wigbaldy family.
He is not here. Has risen, just as he said.
Happy Easter from the Van Buren family.
Hi, Lake Hills family. I might be missing you, but I'm not missing your hugs. Stay safe. Happy Easter from Melissa and Angel.
We miss Lake Hills Church. We miss everything about it, the people, Sunday school, Awana, book clubs, just visiting with everybody.
Happy Easter from the Spreckers.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Happy Easter from the Van Buren family, the three of us.
We love and miss you all.
Happy Easter, Lake Hills, from the Van Buren family.
Good morning and happy Easter from Lake Hills Baptist Church. I am so thankful to actually see and hear several families in that video. So thank you all for sending your videos in. It's just such a great thing to be able to see and hear you guys during this time. So if you would, please join in as we continue with worship.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because. Called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive, he bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
How sweet to hold a newborn baby
joy he gives, but greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he lives, because he lives, like can face tomorrow. Across the river, I'll fight life's fight, no war with him. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he lives, because he lives, like can face tomorrow, because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living, just because he lives, and life is worth the living, just because he lives.
Amen. It's such an awesome thing to know that Christ is alive, and he is everywhere, and he is with us through the good times and through the bad. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just bow before you, your feet this morning, Lord, on this Resurrection Sunday to celebrate your life, the life that you give, the life through bearing the burdens of our sins upon that cross, Lord. We have so much to be thankful for, and we love you. So, Lord, I am praying that we all humble ourselves this morning. I am praying that we bow and we worship and we give our hearts to you. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. So up next, the Lundy family will be sharing their recording of Glorious Day. This song was made popular by the contemporary Christian band Casting Crowns on their 2009 album titled Until the Whole World Hears. Since 2009, this song has been played almost daily from hundreds of Christian stations worldwide. Interestingly, though, this song was actually written in 1908 by J. Wilbur Chapman and published in 1911 in many hymnals. Now, some of you might recognize the hymn version. It's interesting because all of the lyrics that you'll hear are exactly as written from 1908. And so this morning, I'm just praying that you find the love of Christ through everything you're going to hear. The chorus reads, "Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, a glorious day."
Thank you.
Jesus. In our next video, the Huda family shares their version of Love Was When. This song was published in 1970 by John Walvoord and Don Wurtson as part of their 1970 musical titled What's It All About Anyhow? Listening to the lyrics, you will hear the love that God has for us by having sent his son Jesus Christ to bear our sins on the cross. Romans 5 verses 1 and 2 from the ESV says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Romans 5 continues in verses 6 through 8 by saying, "For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God showed his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us."
The song we're going to sing this morning is Man of Sorrows, and the first time I heard that song was here in the living room, so I think it's cool that I get to sing it this morning with you here. I heard it from Emily when she was home from college. She just shared it with me, and I loved the part where it says, "My debt is paid, it's paid in full by the precious blood my Jesus spilled." And I hope that this morning you're able to count Jesus as yours also. Just go ahead and sing with us this morning.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We want to thank these families for these beautiful videos, and they really do help us to feel more together And even though we're scattered all over the county and all over the area, we are still one body in Christ. We're the family of God. We're so glad that you have joined us today and we can be connected in this way. You know, I'm really thankful for the technology that makes all of this possible. And I want to invite you to go ahead and find your Bible. We are going to be using our Bible this morning as we look at the Easter story together there in Matthew, the Gospel according to Matthew. And of course, Matthew was one of the early followers of Jesus, and he was an eyewitness to all of these events. And he recorded them here in his account of the gospel. And we're going to be, the message today is very simple. Jesus is risen, rejoice. It's that simple. You can all say it. Jesus is risen, rejoice. Because he is risen, we can rejoice. I want to invite all of the men out there that are watching online, just say it out loud. Jesus is risen, rejoice. All of the women out there, Jesus is risen, rejoice. How about all of the children out there, good and loud, Jesus is risen, rejoice. And we do rejoice today. What does it mean to rejoice? It means to make Jesus our delight. It means that we are so glad that he has risen from the dead because everything that he said was true. He authenticated his entire life, his ministry, that he is God, that he is real, and that he is the way, the truth, and the life. All of that is authenticated, it's validated by the fact that he rose himself from the dead. We're going to read about that, and we're going to read here in Matthew, and I'm going to begin in actually chapter 27 and verse 62. And then we're going to work our way down through chapter 28. So we're going to be looking a lot at this story of the very first Easter. Matthew 27, beginning in verse 62, says, "On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees gathered together with Pilate, saying, 'Sir, we remember, while he was still alive, how that deceiver said, after 3 days I will rise. Therefore command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last deception will be worse than the first.' Pilate said to them, 'You have a guard. Go your way. Make it secure as you would like to know how.' So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing it with the stone and setting the guard." You know, it's very ironic. It's a piece of divine irony how that those who were most interested in disproving Jesus, in disproving what he said and the fact that he would rise from the dead, the ones who were most interested in disproving all of that, God actually used them to document it the most. Because they secured that tomb and they used a Roman seal and a Roman guard. And of course, we know that the Roman seal would have been the highest law of the land at that time. They would have taken ropes to tie the stone to the wall and they would have sealed it with wax, sealing that knot, that Roman seal on those ropes. And it was a capital offense to tamper with the Roman seal. They couldn't move the ropes. They couldn't move the stone. They couldn't break the seal under penalty of death. And on top of that, there was a Roman guard there. So all of that served the truth. We know that no one came and stole that body because no one would have gone near that tomb because of all of the measures they had taken to secure it. So what happened on that very first Easter? Well, let's read here in verse 1 of Matthew 28, where it says, "Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb." Now it's very interesting that it was on the first day of the week that they came there. You know, one of the remarkable things about the resurrection, and one of the ways that we can know that it is true, is because nothing would have caused these early Jewish believers to change their sacred day, their Sabbath day, from Saturday to a Sabbath of Sunday. It would have taken something very remarkable, very dramatic, for them to stop worshiping on Saturday and to begin worshiping on Sunday. But that's exactly what we have, because on that very first Resurrection Sunday, they came to the tomb, and from that day onward, they always began to gather on the first day of the week. Literally, we celebrate the resurrection every single Sunday as we gather to worship our risen Lord and to remember his death, his burial, and his resurrection that was on the first day of the week. And so that fact itself helps to assert this reality that something very dramatic, something very remarkable occurred on that morning. Now notice verse 2 of Matthew 28. It says here, "And behold, there was a great earthquake, and an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it." Now, why did the angel move the stone? Some of you grandparents out there, later on today, you can quiz your grandchildren on why did the angel move the stone. It wasn't, let me just go ahead and give you the answer, okay? It was not so that Jesus could get out. No, of course we know our Lord Jesus Christ is, he is all-powerful over all of the laws of nature, and he could just simply walk out of that tomb. No, the angel rolled the stone away so that we could see in, so that everyone could know that the tomb was empty. And so we know that Jesus is not there. And we praise God for that. We worship him for that today. Notice in verse 3, it says, "His countenance was like lightning, and his clothes was as white as snow." This is the angel that was there. "And the guards shook with fear of him and became like dead men." Now these were trained Roman soldiers. These were brave men. And yet they were so afraid. Why would they be afraid? Well, my friend, you would be afraid too if you saw this celestial being radiant with light suddenly appear, very powerful, that he could simply move this 2-ton boulder. You would be afraid as well. And notice what the angel says. "He answered and said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified.'" Now notice, he said this to the women. And this is one reason that we can understand and be assured of the reality and the authenticity of this historical account. Because not only is it an eyewitness account, but this is women who are recorded here as being the very first eyewitnesses of the resurrection. Now that's something that they would have never done. They would have never used women as the primary witnesses, especially Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. They just wouldn't have chosen that at random. Because you see, in Roman times, women were not held as credible witnesses. There was a lot of, I guess you would say, male chauvinism in that culture. And women were not allowed to be witnesses in a court of law. They were not deemed credible in their witness. So if you were trying to invent a religion, the first thing that you're not going to say is you're not going to say, "Once upon a time, a group of women saw this or saw that." You wouldn't do it that way at all. And yet, that is exactly what you have here. As a matter of fact, you can look in the Gospel of Matthew, we see here, and the Gospel of Luke, and the Gospel of Mark, and Luke, and John, and they all record women as the first and primary witnesses. Now, this is a beautiful thing. This is really, again, an act of divine providence where Jesus is elevating the position of women in that culture and in our society today as well. You know, women, I praise God for you, because when all of the men ran away and abandoned Jesus, it was the women who were there by his side. They were there when he was carrying his cross. They were standing there at the foot of the cross. They were the brave ones. They were the faithful ones. And here we see they were the last ones to help Joseph lay him in the tomb, and they were the first ones there that morning, and they had the awesome privilege of seeing the risen Lord and seeing that empty tomb. It was the women who were there. Notice what the angel said to them. He said, "He is not here, for he is risen." We're in verse 6. And he said, "Come and see." And see, that's why he moved the stone. He said, "Come in and see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead." You know, it's very interesting how he says, "Come and see," and then "go and tell." And that's exactly what we do even to this day. We come and see, we gather and we hear, but then, my friends, what do? We go and we tell. We tell the story. We tell the good news. And really, the women became the first evangelists. They were the ones who went and told the disciples the good news that Jesus was alive. You know, it was Paul Althaus who said, "The resurrection proclamation could not have been maintained in Jerusalem for a single day, not for a single hour, if the emptiness of the tomb had not been established as fact for all concerned." You see, in a small city like Jerusalem, if the women had gone out telling the tomb is empty, if the disciples had gone on to tell the tomb was empty, all they would have had to have done was simply go to the tomb and examine the body. All they would have had to have done in those very first few days was to simply present the body of Jesus and say, "No, he's dead. Here he is." But they couldn't do that. But you know why? Because he was risen. And Christianity, we do not worship a tomb. We do not revere. There is no shrine in Christianity. Do you know why? Because, my friend, the tomb is empty. It's empty. You know, and even the non-believers of that day, even the Jewish historians admit that the tomb was empty. They do. They do. They simply explain it away by saying that the disciples stole his body. Now notice what it says here in the Bible, though. It says in verse 8, it says, "So they went out quickly from the tomb, and with fear and great joy, they ran to bring his disciples word." You see, there it is. There is the rejoicing. They rejoiced over the empty tomb. It brought them great joy to know that their Savior was alive. And so today, Jesus is risen, and we rejoice. Don't you rejoice today knowing that your Savior lives? Everybody say, rejoice. Can you say that? Say, rejoice. And why should we rejoice? Oh, my friends, we should rejoice. Now, just tell the person next to you. Maybe they're falling asleep. Maybe they haven't had their second cup of coffee. You just tell them, Jesus is risen. Let's rejoice. You know, I want to give you several reasons here this morning why we can rejoice. Actually, I have five, if I can get through all five of them here this morning. And they're very simple. They all begin with P. P, 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 P. That's my favorite letter in all of the alphabet, is the letter P. Do you know why? Because my name begins with a P. No, I'm just kidding. That's just a little bit of humor to, you know, I'm just trying to see if I can make someone laugh hard enough to spill their coffee on their pajamas this morning. Let's look at the first P. Well, let's just look at these P's real quick. The first one is pardon. We can rejoice because our sins are forgiven. These are reasons that we can rejoice today. The second one is power. There is amazing power available to you and I. The third one is purpose. Life has meaning because of the resurrection. And the fourth one is presence. Because he lives, he is with you every single day. And the last one is promise. We have an amazing future because of his promises and what he promises us. Five reasons. Now, the first reason that we can rejoice is because of pardon. Because Jesus is risen, we have forgiveness of our sins. Are you happy that you are forgiven today? You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:17, it says, "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. you are still in your sins. The resurrection makes all of the difference. The Bible says that because of the resurrection, our forgiveness is assured. Romans 4:25 says, He was delivered over to death for our sins, and He was raised to life for our justification. Do you see that there? Of course, He was delivered over to death to die on the cross as the perfect payment for our sins. But then it says that He was raised to life for our justification. Now, there's a very special theological meaning to that verse. What does it mean? Jesus was raised alive to prove to us that His sacrifice was satisfactory. It's more than enough. Jesus rose from the dead to guarantee our salvation, to guarantee our forgiveness. You know, I don't know about you, but I'm excited to know that I don't live under the guilt of my sins. You know, I've been in jail 3 different times in my life. Now, before you go too far with that, I was there to minister to others. I got to leave the same day. But I have been in some, you know, some. I remember one time I was out, and I'm not going to mention the name of the county I was in, but the initials were Marshall County, Indiana. And I was out there, and, you know, I came blowing into town, into Plymouth there, and the very first red light, you know, I got pulled over for speeding. Now, actually, I think it was a speed trap because, you know, it was like the first red light, and he was just sitting right there, and yeah, I think it was a speed trap, but either way, I was speeding, and you know, I was very sorry. I was very apologetic. I was very respectful, and I told the officer there, and he pulled me over on this beautiful motorcycle that he was driving, and I think he appreciated how respectable I was, but he still gave me like a $100 ticket. And then something even worse happened, okay? And I know this is hard for you to believe. Maybe if you know me well, you will understand that I forgot about that ticket. You know, time went by. I was back in Sherville. I was back at home. And all of a sudden, a few weeks later, I got this really ominous letter in the mail about warrants and about appearing before a judge and all of these things. And I started to panic. I started to freak out. And what am I going to do? And that, I was scared to death. I felt the weight of the guilt of what I had done. And I felt the weight of the judgment that I was guilty. And you know, something marvelous happened through all of that. Because right about that same time, I got a phone call. And I got a phone call from a lawyer in Marshall County, Indiana, who, you know, I guess that's what he does. He just finds all of these filings, and he called me, and they began to say, you know, we can apply this, we can do that, and we can make this all go away. I said, let's do that. Let's do that. That sounds like a plan to me. And thankfully, they were able to work through all of that. And the day I got a letter in the mail saying, from the judge, from the court, from Marshall County, Indiana, saying this was all absolved, it had all gone away, I was so glad. I was so glad. And you know what? I was sorry for what I had done. And I took it very seriously. And, you know, I still, if I drive through Marshall County, Indiana, you know, like, thank you to all of the fine citizens of that county because they took away my guilt. And that is a wonderful feeling. It feels like this weight has been taken off of your shoulders when the authority says you are pardoned. Now, next, look what the Bible says in verse 9. It says, and they went out to tell the disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, rejoice. And if you know Jesus, you will not only rejoice, but it says they held him by his feet and they worshiped him. And if you know him, it's not like a get-out-of-jail-free card. If you know him, you will rejoice that you have been pardoned. But my friend, you will worship him. And the early disciples, they dedicated their lives to serving him and to worshiping him. And we see that, you know, but notice not everybody was rejoicing. Look at verse 11. Now, while they were going, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priests all of the things that had happened. Now, it says some of the guards came to the chief priests and reported this. Some, that was like three or perhaps four. Now, there were others. A Roman squad, was four soldiers. And they, no doubt, they would have rotated on different shifts throughout the night. Perhaps there were as many as 16 guards that had been to that tomb overnight or over those period of those days. And when the chief priests met with the elders, and they reported, the Roman soldiers reported to the chief priests all the things that had happened, it says in verse 11. Now you think about that. They reported to the chiefly priests of Israel all of the things that had happened. They reported the angel. They reported that this celestial being removed the stone and that the tomb was empty. They reported the light. They reported that they had seen Jesus risen, that he was there as well. They reported that to all of that to these religious leaders. Notice what it says in verse 2. What was their reaction at the news that Jesus was risen? It says in verse 12, when the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money. How sad. How tragic. Listen, my friends. No amount of evidence about Jesus will convince anyone if their heart is not softened to the gospel, if their heart is not softened to the Lord. Look at the Pharisees. They heard the report, and what did they do? They made up a story. And verse 13, it says, telling them, you say his disciples came during the night and stole him away while you were asleep. Now, first of all, if they were asleep, how would they have known it was the disciples who stole away his body? I mean, the story really doesn't hold up. And it says in verse 14, if this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble. Because the offense, if they were to make up this story, how they fell asleep while they were on watch, well, as a soldier, that would have carried a huge punishment. And so even the religious leaders were saying, we've got your back. You sustain our story, and we will make sure you don't get in trouble for the story. So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among those people to this very day. And that, my friends, is the made-up story of the unbelievers. And listen, no amount of evidence will convince anyone if their heart is not softened to the gospel. You know, I praise God. I stand before you today as a 55-year-old man. And I praise God that all of those many years ago, as an 8-year-old boy, that the Lord Jesus Christ opened up my eyes and opened up my heart to the truth of the gospel. And I could see that Jesus was who he claimed to be, and that it was so, all of this was so utterly important. And what I saw most of all was that there was a God, and his son was Jesus Christ, and he loved me, and that I should love and follow him. I said, I want Jesus. I want Jesus as my Savior. He loves me, and I want to love him. Aren't you so glad that the Lord opened up your heart and your eyes to the glorious truth that Jesus is risen? And because he is, we can rejoice. You know, it goes on, the Bible says in verse 17, and when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Don't you love the honesty of the Bible here and how real it is? Today, many of us will worship Jesus. Literally, hundreds of thousands of followers of Jesus Christ are worshiping him today. But no doubt, surely, some have questions. They have doubts about it. And no doubt, and certainly some do not believe at all. So we're talking about the fact that Jesus is risen and we can rejoice. Do you know why? We can rejoice because of our pardon, but I want you to see also we can rejoice because of power. Notice verse 18, it says, Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Do you know the significance of the resurrected Jesus? That he stands before his followers, risen, glorified, telling them, all power is given to me. All the power in heaven, all of the power on earth has been given to me. You know, who is the most powerful person alive today? Would it be the most powerful president? Would it be Donald Trump? Well, certainly even Donald Trump doesn't have power over the Supreme Court or over Congress. Would the most powerful man in all the world be Putin? Putin, outside of Russia, doesn't have all power outside of Russia. All authority in heaven and earth, that's what Jesus is saying. And what is he telling us? Of course, we know the Lord Jesus Christ, while he was on this earth, he demonstrated his power over the wind. He demonstrated his power when he made the blind to see again. He made the lame to walk, and he healed. He demonstrated his power over disease as he healed so many people. He demonstrated, my friends, his authority and his power over death itself when he raised the dead to life again. And then when he raised himself from the dead, he was demonstrating his power and authority over the grave and over. He has all authority. Do you really believe that he has all of authority? Do you really believe that he reigns over all? Then let me ask you, my friend, why do we worry? Now, certainly we should be concerned about matters of concern, but why do we allow worry to take over our heart? And sometimes we act as if God is not in control. Sometimes we worry because we act as if we do not believe in the supremacy of Jesus, that our God is somehow too small to care for the details of our life. But you know, it means something else when we talk about Jesus having all authority. It means something else. And really, I want to give you a warning right now. I want to warn you, and I'm letting you know right now, that one day the authority of Jesus Christ will judge our lives. He's going to judge the living and the dead, the Bible says. It says in Acts 10 and verse 42, I'll just read it for you. It says, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed judge of the living and the dead. Listen, my friends, the authority of Jesus Christ and the fact that he has power means that we should never take Jesus lightly. Don't be like so many nominal Christians. And don't treat Jesus like he's some kind of celestial Santa Claus. Because, my friend, that is not the case at all. We don't come to Jesus only when we have a problem. We don't come to Jesus when we're sick or this is going bad or we're feeling kind of down or we have a crisis. And then when everything is going well, we just kind of forget about him and put him in the background. Don't treat Jesus like that because he is not a Santa Claus. My friend, he is the risen Lord. He is God. He is the King of Kings. And he has all authority, which means he has authority over all of our lives. And we should honor and respect that. You know, some people, they go to church on Sunday and they listen, but then they live Monday through Saturday like they really didn't learn a thing at all. It really is not important to them. And listen, my friend, perhaps you are a genuine follower of Jesus Christ, and that's wonderful. That's the greatest thing. But listen, do not fall into the trap of being simply a religious person who knows the right answers, but it impacts your life in very little ways. And in public, we act one way, but in private, really, there is no submission and obedience to the authority of Jesus Christ. I would be lying to you If I did not warn you, don't treat Jesus lightly. He is Lord, and one day I will stand before him, and one day you will stand before him. Is there anything in your life that you need to submit, you need to make right, you need to confess to the authority of Jesus Christ? Now, there's another reason that we can rejoice today. We rejoice in the pardon that we have in Jesus Christ. We rejoice in the power that we have in Jesus Christ. But then I want you to see also, we rejoice in purpose. The purpose that his resurrection, the meaning that it brings to our life. You know, so many people do not know the purpose for living. It was Mark Twain who said that the two most important days of your life were the day you were born and then the day you find out why you were born. But I want to alter that. You know, I'm not the first one to do that, but we're going to alter it. We're going to say Phil Twain. This is what Phil Twain says. The three most important days in your life are the day you were born, and then the day you were born again, and then thirdly, when you find out why Jesus allowed you to be born again. And until you find out why God gave you the privilege of being born into his family, then your life will not be fully meaningful. That's what we see here in verse 19 of our passage here, where it says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all of the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Now, in these verses here, there are a lot of verbs. I mean, it says go, it says make disciples, it says baptize them and teach them. But wait a minute, what is the primary verb? What is the primary verb in this verse? It's the verb make disciples. The word go is a participle. It just means while you are going, make disciples. So how do you make disciples? You go. How do you make disciples? You baptize them. How do you make disciples? You teach them all things. What does it mean to make disciples? It means Christ-likeness. So the command is for you and I to help others not only believe in Jesus, but to help others become like Jesus. And that's the mission of Lake Hills Baptist Church. That's the mission of every child of God. And that's your mission. If you believe in Jesus and his resurrection, then your purpose, a huge part of the meaning of your life, is using who you are and the uniqueness of your person and your abilities to use those things to help bring other people to Jesus and to help others become more like Jesus. You know, the word Christian is used in the New Testament a total of 3 times. However, the word disciple is used many, many, many times. Now, let me ask you a question then. Is that the mission and purpose of your life? Christ-likeness? Or is your purpose to make money? Is your purpose to be happy? Is your purpose to find your own comfort? Is that your purpose? Because can I tell you something? God created you for a purpose. And that purpose is to use your talents to help others become more like Christ. Now, you have a job, and perhaps you study, and you're studying for a career, or you're going to school, or you have lots of things that you do, and you have a job where you work. But all of those are pathways. All of those are tools so that you go about your greater mission, your overarching purpose, which is to become more like Jesus, and then to help others become more like Jesus. That's the reality. So, are you investing your life in others to help them to come to know Jesus and to become more like Jesus? You know, at the end of my life, I'm going to leave everything behind. At the end of your life, you're going to leave it all. And there's only a few things that matter for all of eternity. One of them is your own soul. the eternal destiny of your soul is of greater importance and greater worth than all of the things that you can do or accumulate on this earth. The second thing is those you have won to Jesus and the people that you have discipled for Jesus. And my friend, when we're on our deathbed, or when we're in eternity in heaven, the things that are going to be important to us, that we're going to remember, that we are going to value, are our loved ones and those that we wanted to see them saved. We wanted to see them more like Jesus. And then our friends and those around us that we could help in some way impact for the kingdom of God. And so my advice to you, my friend, is to understand God's purpose in your life. You know, I want to move on here, and I want to just share with you as we transition here. Say it together. Jesus is risen. Rejoice. Why rejoice? There are lots of reasons. But for today, let me just give you a couple of more reasons why we should rejoice. First of all, because of his presence. Do you see that in verse 20? His presence. Let them observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of this age. Now that's an amazing promise. I am with you always. The presence of Jesus. You know, the Bible says that in his presence is fullness of joy. In God's presence. You know, I know right now with the shutdown and kind of the lockdown, we're staying in place and we're staying at home a lot. You know, I know there are many of you that are feeling very lonely. And you're struggling with being alone so much and all of the time. And I want to just try to encourage you some with this thought, and that is practicing the presence of God. And just realizing and living in that awareness that the Lord is with you. And he is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He is the one who will never leave you and never forsake you. And so when you wake up in the morning, you can say, "Good morning, Lord." And I know what some of you say when you wake up. You say, "Good Lord, it's morning," right? You can say, "Good morning, Lord." And as you go throughout the day, when you go to work, Jesus goes right there with you. When you go outside, Jesus, let's go. When you go into danger, the Lord is with you. You know, the Bible says in Psalm 34, it says, "The angel of the Lord camps all around them who fear him." Of course, that's a reference to when Israel was in the wilderness and the presence of God was like this pillar of cloud by day and this fiery cloud by night. But they lived with this continual awareness that no matter where they went through the wilderness, that God was right there with them all of the time. And we can practice that awareness, and we don't have a visual sign like they had, but we have the Holy Spirit of God in our hearts. And my friend, a child of God is never truly alone. Now, of course, we need human contact and we're social beings. But at the end of the day, the Lord, his presence is with you and you can rejoice in that. I want you to see, fifthly, that we rejoice in his promise. Notice what it says at the end of verse 28. Even to the end of the age, or to the end of this world, Christ is with us. You know, I said promise, and really, I would have liked to have put the word future there. You know, that's the word that I needed, future. But it's really not a word, so I really couldn't use that, right? But his promises that we rejoice in are concerning the amazing future that he has prepared for you and I. You know, 1 Corinthians 15:51 is a verse that I shared with my dad more than once. He says, "I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trump will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." We shall be changed. You know, my father has been battling cancer for some time now, and recently his blood test markers have been climbing and climbing and climbing. And really, ultimately, it can only mean one thing. And as I see him growing weaker and struggling more, this is the promise that I share with him, and I want to share it with you. that we will all be changed. There is life after death. Jesus is risen, and one day everything will change for the better. You will have a new body. Everything will change. The Bible tells us that it will be so much better. Some of you are wishing that you could have a new body. There are others out there, you're wishing that you could have a new family. Perhaps you come from a broken home or a very dysfunctional family. Perhaps you are in a relationship that is so bad. And perhaps this life has dealt you so much pain and suffering. Can I tell you something? The reality is, Jesus is coming again. And there is life after death. And I tell you that everything will be made new. Everything will change. Revelation 21, verses 4 and 5 say, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain. For the former things will pass away." And he who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." My friend, do you know why you can rejoice? Do you know why you can rejoice? Do you know why the early disciples could endure so much torturing? The truth is that there is so much pain and suffering in this world. But Jesus promised us a future that is truly amazing. A future that is unbelievably wonderful. You could never imagine all that God has prepared for his children. And if you do not even believe in the resurrection, if you knew the amazing, wonderful future that God has prepared, it would make you want to believe in the resurrection. And because of the resurrection of Jesus, we know that everything will be made new, and there is life after death. You know, I don't know what you're going through, but I do have good news that everything will be changed for the better. You know, I want to close with this true story. I know many of you have heard of the Cape of Good Hope. Do you know where the Cape of Good Hope is? If you pay attention in geography class? Well, the Cape of Good Hope is at the southernmost tip of the continent of Africa in South Africa. And at the Cape of Good Hope, it is right where the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean meet. And because of that, it is stormy and it is treacherous seas there. It is very dangerous. And for hundreds of years, no one could pass through that area. And it was known as the Cape of Storms. That was its name. Many lives were lost there. No one could pass over until one day. Until one day there was this brave explorer by the name of Vasco da Gama. And he determined to pass through. And he did. And what he discovered on the other side was this free trade route to India. And he showed the world that this point was no longer a fear-filled Cape of Storms. But he showed them how to pass over. And really, in a sense, it opened up all of the hopes of the European economy and their global trade. And when he discovered that it was possible to go through, they named it the Cape of Good Hope. And my friend, for thousands and thousands of years, people feared death. They feared to die. And they had no idea what was on the other side. It was like this stormy, fear-filled journey. But then, my friend, 2,000 years ago, a brave man, a unique man, a man like no other, the very Son of God, Jesus, he died and he went to the other side and he came back to life to tell you, to tell me, and to tell you, do not be afraid of death, because there is life after death in Jesus. The Cape of Storms became the Cape of Good Hope in Jesus. Jesus is our hope. You know, I don't know whether or not you have Jesus in your life. I wonder if God has perhaps spoken to your heart today, and you want to be sure that Jesus is your Savior. You want to make sure that Jesus is your friend. Well, my friend, if you want to receive the gift of eternal life, the Lord Jesus Christ purchased that gift for you by his death on the cross, and then he assured and guaranteed that gift by his resurrection. And he proved that he truly is God and that everything that he said was true. And you can be sure of your own salvation. You want to know Jesus Christ as your Savior? In this very moment, you can open up your heart in faith to believe in him and to ask him to come into your life, to be your Savior, to be your Lord, to give you that gift of eternal life, the pardon of your sins, and you can rejoice. Let's bow together for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, dear Holy Spirit, we worship you today. We worship you for the amazingly beautiful plan of redemption and how Christ suffered on our behalf and then he rose again triumphant over death and the grave. We thank you for that reality. We thank you, Father, for the forgiveness of sins. And we pray right now for anyone listening to my voice that they would open up their heart in faith, that they would surrender and submit their lives to the authority of Jesus Christ and trust in him as their Savior and their God and their Lord. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Phil. Christ does hold our futures, and we have so much to be thankful for. We're going to sing another hymn. And if you're a member of Lake Hills Baptist Church, we would encourage you to use this time as the tithes and offerings.
How great thou art, how great thou art. Christ shall come with a shout of acclamation and take me home. With joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
so much to be thankful for. And this time of celebration today is a reminder of the love that God had for us by sending his son Jesus to die on the cross for us. Even during times of trials, Christ is there. So let me encourage you beyond today to continue offering Jesus all the thanks he deserves for everything he has blessed us with. As we close, the Ogden family we'll be singing a song called Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. This song of praise paints us a picture that if we were to have 1,000 tongues, we should be praising God with all 1,000 tongues. So as we move forward after today, let us speak and sing praises to the Lord. From the moment we arise in the morning, let us give thanks. Thank God for the day. And let us speak praises into his name all day long. So from Lake Hills Baptist Church, we would like to wish you and your families a very happy and blessed Easter.